passage we're going to be focused on this morning in my message, in our ongoing series in 2 Timothy. This is the passage of which our opening hymn is based. And I'd like us to read Paul's words together, remembering Paul is in prison, nearing the end of his life. All of his closest friends, but a few, have deserted him. He finds himself knowing that martyrdom is fast approaching. And yet this is what he writes, and let's recite this together. For the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Hymn number 409, let's worship together. I know whom I have believed. The Apostle John writes, and this is the record, that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that has the Son has life, and he that has not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you might believe in the name of the Son of God. Father, I pray that our worship today expresses the fact that we know we have eternal life, that our salvation is secure in Jesus Christ, and that there is no other means to heaven but through Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for his sacrifice, that we might receive not only forgiveness, but that we might receive abundant life. And in that abundant life, we live as we walk in the Spirit and live a life that is secure, live a life that has the assurance of eternity with the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. May our worship today be an expression of that assurance. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Please remain standing as we continue to worship together.
If it has been a morning for you, let that just let it go, and let us just worship Christ this morning. all comes down to trust. Trusting in Him. What He says He did, so His word will return to Him. Always it will accomplish what He says it will in you. That you have a plan, that you have a better plan than anything we could ever imagine. We have to trust, no matter how long it takes, that that plan will come to fruition, that it will happen. Because I don't want to get to heaven and say,
I didn't wait long enough. And I hope that none of you do that as well.
Trust in God, trust in His plan. He loves you. Thank you for letting me be here with these people that love you, Father. Thank you for sending the Holy Spirit to be in this place. Thank you for music. Thank you for worship. Thank you for the word of God that we can worship and believe and trust. Amen.
As we return to our verse-by-verse study of the New Testament book of 2 Timothy, I want to begin my message this morning by telling a biblical story. And the story takes place in the book of Acts. The Spirit of God came down in Acts chapter 2, and the disciples had been called by Jesus to preach the gospel. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the other parts of the earth. And so as they went forth, there was opposition. And so in Acts chapter 4, the disciples had been preaching, and they get arrested as recorded in Acts chapter 4, verse 3. Later on in that chapter, they were threatened, but then they were released. And so they go about preaching again, as we read in Acts chapter 5. And this time, there's signs and wonders being done. People are getting healed, others are being saved, and guess what? They get arrested again. But something more happened this time. Listen as I read Acts chapter 5, verse 40. And to him they agreed, and when they had called the apostles and beaten them, they commanded that they should not speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. See, previously they were arrested and threatened. This time they were arrested, threatened, and beaten. All because they were obedient to the call of God on their lives. Never let somebody tell you that when you come into a relationship with Jesus, everything is fine and easy from that point on. It may be fine from an eternal perspective, but it won't be easy. But their response to being arrested, threatened, and beaten is what catches my attention. Acts chapter 5, verse 41, and they, that being the apostles, departed from the presence of the council, the Jewish council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for Jesus' name. Now think about that. It is a fearful thing to be arrested, and then to be threatened, and then to be beaten. But their response is one of rejoicing that they were counted worthy of such treatment. How do we get to that point? Especially because we are such creatures of comfort. I mean, the greatest challenge many of you face is camping. Okay? I mean, we like our temperature-controlled rooms, our temperature-controlled water. We like our food immediate or quicker. And all of this. So how do we get to the point where if there comes a day when we are arrested because of our obedience to Christ, if we are threatened, and dare I say, if we are ever beaten physically, how do we get to that point where we can rejoice? Well, to help answer that, I invite you to open up your Bibles to the New Testament book of 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 1. See, just to put things in context, the Apostle Paul knows that his death is fast approaching. He's been imprisoned in Rome. No hope of release. And so he writes one last letter, this one to his spiritual son in the faith, Timothy. And after his typical greeting, he seeks to both challenge and encourage. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, he writes, "Wherefore I put thee in remembrance, that thou stir up, that thou rekindle, that you would fan the flame of the gift of God, which is in thee by the putting on of my hands." There's the challenge. And the encouragement, verse 7, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear," literally of cowardice, "but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And then Paul will transition in our passage today, verses 8 through 12, in which he lets Timothy know, and therefore all of us know, as followers of Jesus, it is both a privilege to suffer and a privilege to serve. Now, we may not think it is a privilege to suffer. We may not even think it's a privilege to serve. But Paul, writing this final letter of his life, writing under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, has exemplified in his own life it is both a privilege to suffer, to serve, and he encourages Timothy and therefore encourages us. Do we have that perspective? Do we have the perspective this morning? It is a privilege to both serve and a privilege to suffer. That's the message Paul wants to communicate to us today. And the verses 8 through 12, message I've simply titled Suffering and Serving. Let's honor God by standing for scripture reading. 2 Timothy chapter 1, beginning in verse 8. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner. But be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and hath brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, whereunto I am appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. You may be seated. So let's consider the privilege of suffering. The privilege of suffering. He says, be not thou therefore ashamed. His exhortation is in the form of a command. That word ashamed, used three times in this chapter, means to be embarrassed. So Paul is writing to Timothy and he says, I don't want you to be ashamed. I don't want you to be embarrassed, specifically about two things, or rather, two people. First of all, don't be embarrassed about the testimony of Jesus. Speaking of all that Jesus said, all that Jesus did, the events leading up to his betrayal, his death, burial, and resurrection, never be ashamed of Jesus. Second of all, he says, don't be ashamed of me as a prisoner of the Lord. Note how he describes himself. Not as a prisoner of Rome. He views himself as a prisoner. Elsewhere, he says, as a slave to Jesus Christ. He's in the circumstances he's in because he had completely surrendered his life to Jesus Christ. So he says to Timothy, never be ashamed of Jesus. Never be ashamed of me. But then he takes it one step further in verse 8. He says, be thou a partaker of the afflictions. That phrase is in the original Greek language just a single word in which he is saying to Timothy, join me in suffering for Christ. Now, Paul knew something about suffering. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 28, he summarizes the sufferings he's experienced, being beaten, and shipwrecked and stoned and all these things, all out of obedience to the calling of God. And he says to Timothy, hey, join me in this. Could you imagine if every altar call, every time people were invited to come into a relationship with Jesus Christ, the teacher, the pastor, the preacher said, hey, join with me in a life of suffering and submission and service. That isn't how we get people's attention. And yet that is what we are signing up for. And so we need to be honest in preaching all the counsel of God, because Paul is saying, hey, Timothy, if you follow Christ, there will be suffering. And don't forget, it is a privilege to suffer. And to do so according to the power of God. I love Paul when he talks about the power of God. It's a power to change lives. Listen to what he said to the church at Rome, Romans chapter 1. He says, for as much as in me, I am ready to preach the gospel, the good news, to you that are in Rome also. For I am not ashamed, same phrase, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. The greatest evidence that there is a God is not Mount Salk. Okay? The greatest evidence that there is a God is not creation. But the greatest evidence that there is a true and living God is a changed life. You and I get to demonstrate how God is so powerful. Because he can take you and I, destined for eternity in hell, and change our heart, change our desires, so that we live godly lives. That's the power of the gospel. Godly lives that may lead to suffering, godly lives that may lead to serving, but godly lives nonetheless. Why? Because he continues, God has called us with a holy calling. A calling unto salvation, a calling unto a life of sanctification and holiness, as we've been seeing in the adult Sunday school class. And none of this is according to our works. None of us can stand before God and say, God, you got me now. Aren't you glad I'm part of the family of God? Because look at everything I bring to the table. I know from a coaching standpoint, there are kids who have come on my volleyball court, my basketball court, as if I am so blessed that they showed up. Can I get an amen, Kevin? Yeah. And it's so funny, because you can't teach them anything, even though they're only sixth and seventh graders. But God loves them too. And God is patient with us, and I'm patient with them, and we all need to be reminded, we don't bring anything to God but sin and sinfulness, but he wants to change our lives according to the power that's working in us. And when did this process begin? He says, who was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. Paul writes to the church at Ephesus, according as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. God purposed that you and I would be part of the family of God before day one of creation. Now, you may have a hard time reconciling that in your head, and that's okay. But do not deny the teaching of Scripture that before the world began, God chose you in Jesus Christ to be part of the family. It's not because of what you had to bring to the table, but it was according to his divine purpose. It was according to his divine grace. We are saved. We are set apart because of the will and work of God. And our response is like it was this morning, one of worship. He says in verse 9, he was saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now revealed by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Christ was hidden in the Old Testament. He's revealed in the New Testament, who hath abolished or literally made of no impact or death. We still die physically, but what he's addressing is spiritual death. For the wages of sin is death, physical and spiritual, but the gift of God is what? Eternal life through Christ Jesus, our Lord. So we need not fear death, but is now being manifest by the appearing of our Savior, who has abolished death and has brought life, just what he said back in verse 1, and immortality to light through what? The gospel. See, when we keep our eyes fixed upon the gospel, suffering is a privilege. Jesus looked past the cross, and according to the book of Hebrews, saw you and I the fruit of the cross. He endured suffering so that we might experience eternal life. Jesus, up on the cross, had the power to say, I'm done with this. He had the power to call a legion of angels to deliver him. But he accepted betrayal. He accepted his closest friends deserting him. He accepted being beaten, whipped. The book of Isaiah says his face was beyond recognition. He was spit upon. All of that before he was asked to, not asked, commanded to carry the cross. And then having nails piercing his skin. And he looked beyond all of that and he saw you. Not just us collectively, but you individually. And said, this is worth it. So that my creation, speaking of you and I, can experience relationship with you. And he is our example. That's why after they were arrested, threatened, beaten, they rejoiced. Because they got to experience suffering like their Savior. What a privilege. He says also, beginning in verse 11, it's a privilege in serving. He said, I am appointed, his divine call on the road to Damascus, in three roles that Paul was given. He's a preacher, somebody who proclaims the gospel. He's an apostle, a messenger, an ambassador on behalf of the gospel. And he's a teacher primarily to the Gentiles. And then he says once again in verse 12, for the which cause I suffer. He never loses sight of the suffering. But I suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed. I am not embarrassed of my life. I am not embarrassed of the one that I serve, Jesus Christ. For I know, I have this absolute assurance, I know whom I have believed. It is not merely an intellectual belief. It is not an intellectual acknowledgement. That word believes means to trust, to place one's weight on. He says, I know in whom I trust. I know in whom I place my weight on today. And he goes further when he says, I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded. I have the sense of assurance. There is not any shadow of doubt. I am absolutely convinced. If he wasn't convinced, would he endure what he endured? The answer to that question is no. But I know whom I have believed in, and I am persuaded that he is able Not Paul is able. God is able. But it's interesting, the word chosen here. He says that he is able to keep, literally to guard and protect, which is fascinating when you consider what immediately follows, that which I've committed. It is a banking term. It is a financial term, meaning to place a deposit, and specifically in this context, place a deposit in a vault that is guarded and protected by God himself. That's what salvation is. You are surrendering control of your life. You are placing it in the hands of God to guard and to protect, as if you were making a deposit in a vault located in heaven. That's why whatever Paul experienced, he knew it was, as he says, a light affliction. Because at best, it was temporary. And at worst, it was temporary. Because Paul never lost sight of eternity. For I know whom I have believed in, and am persuaded that he is able to keep, to guard, to protect that which I've committed unto him against that day. In chapter 4, look at me in chapter 4, verse 8. Same phrasing. Chapter 4, verse 8. Actually, in context, verse 7. I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me. Here's that phrase. At that day. So let me kind of fill out what he means by that phrase. And let me read it directly from my notes. There will come a day when every believer stands before the judgment seat of God, Romans chapter 14, and will have the quality of their works judged, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and we will receive our just reward, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. The judgment day for believers is not a judgment about life and death, heaven or hell. That issue has been settled. But we will stand before God and receive our reward for any works done in his name. That's what Paul addresses in chapter 3 of 1 Corinthians when he talks about our works, wood, hay, and stubble, that which was done not for the glory of God, but for our own benefit. Our own applause, if you will. So what Paul does in this passage is he brings forth, it is a privilege to suffer, it is a privilege to serve. I'm not saying it's easy to get to that point. But one of the challenges we have is realigning our thinking. So let me address both of these quickly. And let me do so in reverse order. First, the privilege of serving. Paul said he had three roles. He was a preacher, he was an ambassador, he was a teacher, an instructor. I don't know what roles you have in the kingdom of God. But may I suggest locations? Three areas. Serve God by serving your family. Serve God by serving in your church. And serve God by serving in your community. I don't know what gifts God has given you, but God has called you to serve. And notice those circles. It begins with those closest to you, which is often the hardest. Because they know you the best, and you know them the best. But we serve God in our immediate family, we serve God in our church family, and we reach out and serve God in our community. All as a privilege. How do I know that? Listen to what Paul says in Colossians chapter 3. Whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Colossians 3:23. And whatsoever you do, to which I would add, and wherever and however you serve, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men. It is a privilege to serve your spouse. It is a privilege to be a servant in your family. I'm not saying it's easy, but I am saying it is a privilege. It's a privilege to be serving in the body of Christ and using your gifts to edify and build up one another. It's a privilege to reach out, to be in the heart of the community, ever seeking to reach the community's heart by sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. But it is also a privilege to suffer. That's what the apostles experienced. That's what Jesus promised in John 16. He says, in the world you will have tribulation. He didn't say in the world some of you may have a trial or two. No, he said you will have tribulation. Paul later on, as we will see in chapter 3, says all who live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. Yeah, that'll get crowds coming. But you know what's interesting is the company we keep. We keep when we suffer for the cause of Christ. At the end of the Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5, listen to this. Blessed be they that are persecuted for righteousness' sake. In other words, they're not persecuted because they're sinners. They're persecuted because they're following Christ. For theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you when men shall revile you, persecute you, and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. And then he says this, rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Jesus, in the beginning of his ministry, said, hey, persecution is part of the game plan in your life. Suffering is what you signed up for. And if you didn't know that by now, I'm glad I have the privilege of letting you know what you're in for. So when it happens, and it will happen if it already hasn't happened, and some of you are experiencing it right now, you will not be surprised. You will not say, oh my goodness, why is this happening? I'm a child of God. No, so your response is, hallelujah, I get to suffer like Jesus. I get to be persecuted like the apostles? Wow! What a privilege! It may take you some time to get there. I began with a story, and I want to close with a story. During the Boxer Rebellion back in 1899 to 1900, which was in China, extreme nationalist Chinese generated this campaign of terror against foreign governments, Christian missionaries, and even Chinese Christians. And in the story, they surrounded this mission statement. They sealed all the exits except for one. They placed a cross in the dirt in front of the open gate. And they told the missionaries and the students that anyone who walked out and trampled the cross would be spared. According to reports, the first seven students who departed trampled on the cross and were sent on their way. The eighth student, a young girl, approached the cross, knelt down, prayed for strength, and walked around the cross. She was immediately executed. The remaining 92 students, having seen the example of this young girl, walked around the cross to their execution. And for each one, an eternal reward for surrendering their lives for the cause of Christ. Just because the persecution has yet to hit our shores, like we read in the scriptures, trust that it is happening around the world today. And I firmly believe at some point it will cross our borders. And at some point our nation will turn its back. And Christians alone will stand for the gospel of Jesus Christ and truly suffer for it. Selfishly, I hope not my lifetime, nor my children's lifetime or grandchildren's lifetime. But the simple reality is this. First of all, we ought to be prepared. That's what Paul is communicating. And second of all, if and when it does happen, we ought to rejoice. Because it is an incredible privilege to both serve the cause of Christ and, if necessary, suffer for the cause of Christ. Let's pray. Father, I ask that the words of Paul, the words of Scripture, will penetrate our hearts and our minds, that we would understand the privileges that we possess as Christians. I pray, Father, that whether in our homes, schools, work, or social places, that we would never be ashamed or embarrassed to stand up for Jesus Christ. That we would not remain silent, but steadfast. That we would be free, regardless of how others respond. We would be free and bold in proclaiming Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Give us that courage. Give us that strength. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite you to remain seated for a closing song that I want to introduce this way. When Jesus truly is all to us, both serving and suffering is a privilege. That is, if he is our precious cornerstone and our sure foundation.
be where we are walking with you as well. In the name of Jesus.
Will you stand with me? It was Paul's fervent hope and desire for Jesus to be everything to Timothy and to everyone he shared the gospel with. Paul summed up that passion in the following words written to the church at Philippi when he said, speaking of Jesus, that I may know him, that I may know the power of his resurrection, that I may know and experience the fellowship of his sufferings, that I might be made conformable unto his death. Oh, that you may know Jesus that way.